I pray after all this series of message, you can replace
that with what you have in mind. And today I'm going to touch one thing. It's very, very important to all of us. I think what I'm going to do today, I'm going to feel that was is more than a house. Turn to the neighbor and say it's more than a house. I've seen many people who basically invest so much in their house, maybe plural, houses, mortgages, investment plans, what neighborhood to live, and they just hold on to the house. And I just feel
so the Psalm 90, if you look at it, they were about to start 40 years of journey in the wilderness where they could not have houses. That's why Psalm 90 written in a way by Moses to anticipate this 40 years of circling around with no houses. They live in tent, basically. So God put this message in me is, if you and I need to step into what God intended for you and me, we have to let go of houses. Is that clear? Oh, I look at all you like, oh, Pastor, am I selling my house? No. I'm talking about mentally, physically, emotionally, we are not slave to our house. Amen. Oh, I'll get very few amen here. Let me try it again. The message is very simple. Is we are not slave to what the house represents to us. We are not slave to we have to be a husband or wife taking the bread back, putting it on the table. I pray we will see a higher purpose why God gave us a house. Is that okay? So we need much more than a house. Amen? For example, in a house, there must be the head of a house. That's the Christian talk, right? Few other places talk about head of house, like we talk about in the church. Who is the head of the house? Raise your hand right now. In your house. Thank you, Daniel. Thank you, Henry. Thank you, YK. Paul, you are not the head of your house? Maybe your dog, Lanny, is the head of the house. Some people, their pets are the head of the house. You could tell once you walk in. But you know, the head of the house is supposed to be Jesus Christ. Wow. So all the men in this house, you are called the head of the house from the Bible, from Ephesians, from New Testament and Old Testament as well. But I want to listen to this music. It's touched my heart called Lead Me. It's written by the songwriter. He was an uprising Christian singer, musician. He has 4 kids. He traveled a lot. He was on the road. He was successful. His career is taking off. But then he had few time with his wife and kids. So he's always on the road until one day he wrote this song as the head of the house. I want to start with this song. Is that okay? Key, are we ready for the sound? All right. It's one of the lyrics, don't leave me hungry for love, chasing dreams, but what about how us? So yeah, it's more than a house, a head of a house. Are you ready?
See my wonderful life, almost perfect from the outside. In picture frames, I see my beautiful wife, always smiling, but on the inside, oh, I can hear her saying, lead me with strong hands, stand up when I can't, don't leave me hungry for love, chasing dreams, but what about us, show me you're willing to find that I'm still the love of your life, I know we call faces, look in their innocent eyes, they're just children from the outside, I'm working hard, I tell myself they'll be fine, they're independent, but on the inside, oh, I can hear them saying, lead me with strong hands, stand up.
What are you doing now that will outlive you? If as a head of the house, our main job is to bring the bread on the table, but leave the house empty, will this outlive you? If we are moms in the house, and our job is to just bring food on the table, that's going to outlive us or not? That's what Psalm 90 is trying to answer. So more than a house. I love this one. I'm not playing it anymore. I'm going home. I'm not playing the house game anymore, folks. I'm done with it. People come to me in their 60s and say, Pastor Conley, we are downsizing. I say, I already downsized 10 years ago. Oh, you don't know how difficult to downsize. Already downsized from the waterfront house, a mansion, come to Princeton, the half basement. I did it already. But folks, I have a message for you. I'm down. I'm so much down. Like, I'm not playing anymore. I'm not living just to pay mortgage to the house. Amen? I'm done with just raising up next generation to go to Ivy League. I'm done with it, amen? I'm not playing anymore. I'm going home. I want a home. I want a home. That's what Psalm 90 is so powerful, talking about God, you have been dwelling place for us through generations. Moses started with that. You are our dwelling place. It's not our tents. It's not our house, our three-bedroom townhouse, or four-bedroom big house, or thousand-bedroom mansion. It's not that. Much more than that, amen? I'm going home. I know, and a Christian step out. Coach K, Pastor, I'm so touched my heart. You know, I can't pay my mortgage, and I know it's hard. So I'm going home, right? You mean that we are going to Heavenly Father's presence, and, you know, we just forget about this world, right? And, you know, no, that's not, it's not what I'm talking about either. We are not escaping from this world, amen? Jesus said we are in this world, but now we are not of this world. When Abraham was on the run, well, when I said he was really a traveler, he actually made every place he settled down, just temporarily or for a couple years, a home. Why I know it? Because he built an altar. If you have time to build an altar, sacrifice animal, and try to bring your family, you know he settled down. He made that place his home. Although his heart has that longing for the ultimate promised land, but he made every place a home. Now, I have so many Christians like never make where they are a home. I pray we are in between these two ends of the spectrum that I'm going home. So there's one person wrote this one. I love it so much. I'm going to rewrite it. It's home is more than a house. Turn to your neighbor, more than a house. Are you serving the house right now? Are you serving the mortgage? Are you serving? Is a fear coming from you? I cannot pay my mortgage. If that's the case, can we settle the case today? Try it again. Are you living under the fear that one day I cannot pay my mortgage? Anybody? Can we settle that fear today? Otherwise, we'll never make our place a home. You'll make it a house. You will have all the excuses. I'm working. I'm doing this because of this house. Have you ever heard this? Like, I'm doing all this. I'm working so hard. I'm working for this house. But the house is so empty. So you say, house. There's an echo in the house. The house is so big. I'm working for this home. I've seen so many parents save money, save money, save money. And all the kids end up not coming home. So they have all the money under the earth. But nobody going to use it. So I have money. The house is so big. Money. The echo. Sound like a prophet in Old Testament when he was under the belly of the big fish. Who that person is? Jonah. Jonah said, who is there? I'd rather to have a home. Not big, just enough. But when I say food, boom, food is gone. How about that? When I say let's play football, we have a team coming up. I'd rather to have a place we call home, not just a house. Young people, if you want to get a better job, better salary, just to get a big house, let's settle that issue today. Let's settle it right now. I'm not asking you not to have a big house. We had a big house. Huge waterfront house. We can enjoy it, but it cannot be our master. Is that okay? Yes, can be our master. Sir, ladies and gentlemen, can we make it clear? It's more than a house. It is a sacred location, a place of aspiration, and dreams of learning and habit, of relationship and heart, I want to go to that home. I'm going home. I'm going home. I'm done with house. I'm done with a big house, small house, whatever you call it, or living in a van right next to the river. Nobody get this joke, but anyway, you know what the joke is? A lot of motivational speakers, they go upstairs, they are all dressed up, but actually live in a van right next to a river. So you don't get it. That means motivational speaker couldn't even make a living on their own. Make sense? So you don't get it. Okay, anyway. Home is the geography of our soul. We need the sound of grandchildren in the house. We need the sound. When I say that, not necessarily from your bloodline, I need a spiritual children sound in the house. If you have spiritual children, their children will be your spiritual grandchildren. Amen? I want to hear that young people playing. And Jimmy was in my house on Friday night making joke. And Monica brought in a kind of Korean food called, it's a lava. What do you call this? Pupa. Remember that one? So my house smelled like dead fish, the whole house. I want the house to fill with babies crying. I want the house to fill with the worship sounds. I want the house to be lively with energy, with people. I call it a home. A geography of our souls. A lot of ethnic background, you know, always replace our souls. Our means my bloodline. Whoever have blood and flesh is me. That's my household. Can we settle that issue today too? That if you are willing and I'm willing to extend that line with God's plan in our hearts, that we are able to take other people into our house. Call it a home. That's called church. That's it. That's church. Folks, that's church. So I'm going to watch this. I modify with Psalm 90 because I'm not a native English speaker, so I have to take that lady's work. Mingle a little bit. That's how our young people are doing their homework too, right? Google it and just make sure paraphrasing checker don't check you, and we are all set. Okay, that's how I'm doing it because I'm not a native speaker. So I admit it. I take that lady's wonderful writing, I think she wrote a very, very biblical stuff. But I put in what Psalm 90 was talking about. I also take into what I'm going to preach today, three things from Hebrew, talk about Moses is superior and greater than Moses, who wrote Psalm 90. So I take the New Testament and also into, so I make this video clip. It's my statement. So if you say it's not biblical, oh, go check it out. Talk to the theologian and come back. We'll change because it's not mine anyway. But this is my heart. I'm done playing the house game. I'm done. I'm so done with it. I want to go home. I want to find a home. Are you ready? Okay. Clear. Sound. Ready? Let's unveil Coach K's Google video clip. Here we go. Can you turn to your neighbor and say, we are God's house. Amen. It's more than a house. God find a home. God find a home in you and me. He called it his home, his dwelling place. It's not an individual thing. Home. I'm so done with playing the game in the house, but I long for this home right here on the earth. It has to go through Jesus Christ. I have no other way I can really. Young people, don't come to me and say, Pastor, you are so old-fashioned. You know, Jesus is kind of out of date. Folks, without Jesus, Xiao and I probably could have divorced already. Do you believe it? We've been married for what, 20? See, that's why we really run the risk of divorcing, because we don't even remember how many years we, you know what I'm saying? Like, what is the anniversary? Oh, see, I don't even pass a test right now. And the only thing I can see is we have a relationship where the way I get closer to my wife is not because of a huge house. It's not because of a stable job. It's not because we are old gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen. Because in the real marriage, all the facade is gone. Make sense? You see your spouse never wearing a makeup in the morning. Who wears makeup in the morning? And you will know all the interesting habit of the other significant one. And usually they poke you in the most inconvenient moment, that before you have to go to a very important meeting, they will throw one sentence and that will bother you for a whole day. Make sense? Oh, yeah. And when they are sick, and you actually are sick too, because you just don't know how to deal with it, we are carrying the same yoke. But one thing that I know, without Jesus, we can't call our place a home. We both need to find a home inside our heart first, a home for Jesus Christ, where he called it comfortable home. As we both get closer to him, just like a triangular relationship. How people say, Pastor, you preach about a third person in your marriage. Yes, I'm preaching about it. Third person in a relationship. His name is Jesus. So, Xiao and I both approach Jesus. We get closer to each other. Make sense? Does that make sense? If you don't have that third person, I want her to get closer to me. Do you think she wants to? No, come on. No. Because I want to eat hot pot, spicy hot pot. I want to, Xiao Hui, let's go. She's not coming. And she put on the table all the super healthy food. I'm not going. No way. No way, Kia, no way. But I managed to do one thing. She didn't want to eat sashimi, raw fish. I was successful to now pull her in. She's eating a lot more sashimi than I am. Amen. And she had Zach, who is eating more sashimi even. So I'm like successful along that line. Amen. So if I don't have Jesus, I have sashimi. Work out kind of okay. But you can't have sashimi solve your problem all the time, right? Right? Is that right? We all get closer to sashimi and the marriage problem is solved. Does that make sense? No, you can't. Where is my son going to college? If we don't agree, let's buy sashimi. Or go to a college campus who offers sashimi in the cafeteria. Joyce, your school is so outrageously crazy. So go to that school. Their cafe actually offer sushi and all everything. All you can eat. I'm like, oh, I'm going there. No, folks, I'm speaking my heart. I'm not. I'm looking for a home. And God, through His Son, Jesus Christ, is looking for a home in your heart. If you have Christ Jesus in your heart, finding a home, then we are qualified to be able to really enjoy the intimacy and enjoy each other. Amen? If God cannot find a home in us, we cannot even enjoy ourselves. If you are with me, raise your hand. Aha, thank you. Jesus is greater. I need Him. That's why Psalm 90, you have to read it with Hebrew, because I believe Psalm 90 is a very unique psalm, but you have to be coming to the book of Hebrew in the New Testament to unlock it. If you look at that role of Jesus throughout making a home, in Hebrews 3, 1-3, Moses was also faithful, right? But he says, take a look at heart, look at Jesus. He's a centerpiece. Tell your neighbor, centerpiece. Centerpiece. One more time, centerpiece. Of everything we believe, faithful in everything God gave him to do. You see that? That's why I talk about the centerpiece of that triangle. The centerpiece of your house. If your centerpiece of a house is a stable job, can we deal with that today? Settle it. It cannot be the centerpiece of your house. Cannot be just a stable job. With me on this one. It has to be more than that. Moses was also faced, but Jesus gets far more honor. A builder is more valuable than building themselves. So the first thing I want to share with you is Jesus is the centerpiece of your house. Then you can call it a home. Amen? Is Jesus the centerpiece of your house? A lot of Christians are walking, they put a banner, something called what? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, right? But somebody gave me a blanket. So every time I put a blanket on, it's always as me and this is not my house. We will serve nothing. So it's, you know, the blanket. So it's me, serve. It's very funny. So I have to really open up. As me and my family, we will serve who? Serve a job? Serve a degree? Serve who? Thank you, Lisa. By the way, Lisa is going through election right now, right? So I can make an advisement, but she's going for the council member. We're in Princeton. Few of us have the voting rights, so I can advise for you. So God bless her. If you get elected, praise God, the first Republican ever is a liberal town, but hallelujah. Praise God. Jesus needs to be the centerpiece of a house. But you know, today, home is where Wi-Fi automatically connected. If your home doesn't have a Wi-Fi, you don't have a centerpiece. Promise me. I promise you. Your centerpiece is gone. Totally gone. All right? But if you walk in, your Wi-Fi connect automatically. That's called home. I pray Jesus will be like that. When you walk home with your next generation, we have a centerpiece called Wi-Fi to the heaven. Amen? That you can freely talk about Jesus and your relation with them with no condemnation. We talk about drug addiction on Friday. All the young people, you know, thank you for your contribution. But I found one thing. Drug, today, you cannot just make it a under-table item. Like, oh, just don't talk about it. Are you taking drug? No. Drug is an issue. We are able to talk on the table. Is that okay? Is that okay, family? Because no condemnation. We don't encourage you to take drugs. But when I say that, 90% of young people say, maybe I should try it. You see that? Like, oh, let's try it. I have the freshman calling back and, Coach K, so much drug in the dorm. Yeah? Alcohol and what? Drugs. So I pray Jesus will be the centerpiece of the house. That's another your 3C products, right? So we were on Yellowstone National Park. When we drove into the park, there's no whatsoever signal. Oh, I love it. Then after a while, we automatically abandon our weapon, surrender our cell phone, iPad, surrender, total surrender. I surrender, no Wi-Fi. I surrender, 4G becomes 3G and 1G and nothing. Oh, to Jesus, I surrender, oh. We need this. Okay, Merry Christmas. Look at this dad. It's like, what can we do? Actually, this is the wrong picture. It should be mom here and dad there, right? Huh? Oh, he's watching TV. Okay, so. I'm sorry. All right. So I thought he's like really, really serious. He got a football game. No, I'm not saying don't watch football again. Go watch it. I love it. But folks, we all have this excuse. I need relax, so I do it. But when you are home, you are home. You are not home. You're like, oh, I watch football game. But watch with somebody, your friend. Watch it in a small group. Don't give you excuse like, oh, I'm watching game, you know. Happy moments, what? Difficult moments, that's making centerpiece. Quiet moment, painful moment, every moment. So I will teach about Thanksgiving. Hopefully, a thankful heart is a gateway to put Jesus Christ at the center of our house. Amen? All right. Every house has a builder. Hebrew continue. The builder behind them all is? God is a builder. So the second truth I want to share with you is the builder of my house is Jesus Christ. Amen? Oh, you say amen, but a lot of people say, I am the builder of the house. I used to be like that. I have to bring the bread back to the table. Otherwise, I'm the sole bread bearer and all that. But who is the real builder of the house? God is a real builder. He's building more than a structure. He's building more than finances. He's building a geography of souls. That's in you. You are so precious. If you want to change the world, go home and love your family. That's from Mother Teresa. You like her or not, but I think it's a very good quote. Yeah? Does she have a home? No, she never married. But she did have a home. It doesn't mean you have to get married to get a home. If you get home and you're willing to extend that boundary of your limitation, God can make you a home. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul longs, even faints for you. Psalms 84, 1 to 2. Even the sparrow has found a home, and has swallowed a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altar, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. I pray some of us at Agape House, that your place one day or now will be filled with sparrows, swallows for nest. Not just for your own children, but for God's children as well. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, yet not one of them will fall into the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hair of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid, you are worth more than many what? Sparrows. So I'll talk about this one very, very, very careful. The builder is basically mean the designer, but more than a designer. Builder is the one who actually make it happen. We are more precious than sparrow, right? But sparrow doesn't know one thing. sparrow doesn't know the principle of sowing and reaping. We are more precious than sparrow because we know the principle of sowing and reaping. Maybe I should preach about this. I was in Albany. My pastor there preached Mark 4. Is it Mark 4? Mark 4, about sowing and reaping for a year and a half. Every Sunday message, he talked about sowing and reaping for a year and a half. In other churches, the pastor probably get fired already. Every Sunday you come in, he talk about sowing and reaping. But folks, that year, Xiao and I transformed totally. We start to understand resources in my hand. Treasure, money, time, and talent in my hand are all items I'm able to smartly, wisely sow, and I'm going to reap from it. Amen? I'm free to be able to manage the resource I have. I'm willing to give. Amen? And give generously. Because I start to see we are reaping from what we sow. Amen? So I'm encouraging you. I'm so blessed with the third quarter report on finances. God is so good. But I pray, if you want to be the builder of your house, we got to know how to sow, how to invest in people, invest in the right people. Amen? Hallelujah. Okay, I'm going to finish up here. Number three, Moses did a good job in God's house, which, you know, Psalm 90, but it was all servant work, getting things ready for what was to come. But Christ, the Son, is in charge of the house. Amen? So it says, now if you can only keep a firm grip on the bold confidence, we are the house. Amen? So number three truth is we are the house. Turn to your neighbor and say, we are the house. We have turned our eyes away from those material things that will pass away. Those things are important. Yes, they will come. As we seek God's kingdom and righteousness first, these things will be added unto us. House will come, job will come, finance will come. But we have to turn our eyes to see what the most valuable thing in the house is, the people. Amen? We are the house. Turn to your neighbor again. Say, we are the house. I'm thinking like Japan is so into the robotic stuff. Well, one day will be a home just for robots. Do you want to go to our home? You're walking and say, oh, hey, robot. Every robot is so pleasing and so, hi, Kier, how are you? They will never fight with you. They will be your servant. You just program it. They will help you exercise. They will put the food to you. They will just, you know, turn on the TV for you. And they will just walk the dog. And they say, robot, walk the dog. Nobody to have to take care of the dog, right? And do you want to live in a robotic home? No, come on, be honest. Yeah, see, I know you are not honest with me. Do you want to live in a robotic home? Yes. Some of you, especially dad and mom, you actually be that robot in the home for a while, right? You're the one who serve, wash the dish, walk the dog, clean up the poop, vacuum the floor. When you and I do those things, if we know, if our focus is on Christ as a centerpiece, He's building something. We are looking at aspiration. We are looking at the story. We are looking at underlying testimony that God is bringing up people in our household. That is different. Amen? We are the house. I'm going to finish up. How do you like this? I love James Dobson. His son also grew up to be a psychologist. He said he's very impressed with one thing, his father, a statement. When he was grow up as a boy, I think they raised up boys, three or four boys in their house. So Dr. James Dobson, they have a big lawn like this, but the lawn is, the grass is worn out because they keep playing football, they keep rolling on it, right? And the neighbors had to complain and say, Dr. Dobson, your lawn doesn't look, you know, belonging to this community. And his son remembered his father, Dr. James Dobson, reply. He said, "Sorry, mister, we'll do the best job we can, but we are raising up boys. We are not raising up lawns. We are raising up boys. We are not raising up lawns." Some of the high older people in this room. Oh, sorry, now when I go home, I'll be in trouble. Please excuse our messy home. No, I'm not using excuse to be messy at home, okay? My home looks pretty good, all right? We are busy making memories. Is that okay? Yeah? All right, so don't come to me and say, don't go home and say, "Today the church talk about home supposed to be messy, so we can really, you know." No, don't go there, okay? I say we are busy making memories, okay? Hallelujah. Can we let go of some of this kind of things that hinder your relationship? Can you let go just a little bit? Is that okay? Can we settle that issue right now? Oh, this is a message that please nobody. Hallelujah. Home is more than a house. It's a sacred location, I inject, filled with God's presence. A place of aspiration through Jesus Christ as a foundation, and dreams of learning the habits of relationship at heart. Home is a geography of our soul, and we are the home. Is Jesus Christ the centerpiece of your house, just like a Wi-Fi? Can we just bring him to recognize he is the builder of the house? Lay our burden on him. Use your money wisely. Guys, don't just save up. Don't use it. You know, I know. Maybe we should teach you about it. You save enough, but don't save every penny. Is that okay, folks? Can I be very honest? This is time that we invest money for people. Is that okay? This is not biblical. But this is from my heart. When I say it's not biblical, because, you know, all the theologian call me, the Bible talk about it. All right, so but my heart is like, if your saving instinct is so strong, can we let Jesus decide how we build this house? Amen? That's what I'm trying to say. Final thing, we are the house. Amen? And this is Agape House. I try my best when we are building this house. I try my best to look beyond just buildings and programs, institutions, rules. I'm doing my best so that you are the house. We are the house, organically. The church is called Organic Church because people is a church. Not other things. Can I play that video one more time? I'm promoting my own thing, but no, this Coach K with the Google help and some video software, AI software, that's it. So I don't have a very artistic stuff, but if you got to improve on this one, you're welcome. Well, I'm going to play it one more time. I'm playing. I'm to call out partners. I'm like, I'm done playing the game. I'm done playing the house game. I'm going home. If you're willing, I'm playing this. Would you come forward to join me up front? I don't know what I'm going to do. I just feel Holy Spirit want to settle this issue with you and me today. Like, we don't have all the excuses. Wi-Fi is not an excuse. Our finance is not. Our centerpiece is not just a job. Amen? It's not just raising up Ivy League students. No! Are you with me, with God on this one? If that's the case, that's Agape House. So I'm praying, Lord, lead me so I can stand up and fight, so I can lead them. I pray that will be the leadership you ask of me, to be the head of the house. But we know you are the centerpiece of the house. You are ultimately the builder, the planner, the designer, and the finisher of my home. And we are the house. Let me turn my eyes around to look at people who you entrust in my hand, that I can serve them and lead them. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to pray one more time. Play one more time. What am I talking? My English usually get after 2 hours of worshiping and all that. But I'm playing this for myself. So if you want to join me up from, I don't know what I'm going to do. Well, I'm going to ask Lisa on here, would you come up, stand in the middle? Or maybe here, right here. I'm a little bit tired. Here, right here. 10 years ago, I could do this until afternoon. I can now. So I'll get a couple here. I'm going to stand right here. So don't come to me. Come to them. Now, if you feel there's something going on in your house, physical condition, do not let those sickness become the centerpiece of your house. I feel the Holy Spirit say that. Do not let sickness become the centerpiece of your house. Amen? Let's turn it around. So I want you to come forward around to that side. Okay? I'm going to play it one more time. Home. Much more than a house.